A man in a mask was standing in the lobby of a bank when his police scanner fired up. After listening to the barely legible chatter, he rushed back into the vault. "Boss, we got a problem. Cops know we're here, and they're coming full force," the man said. "Abort the job. We're leaving," the boss replied.
Wait, hold on. We did all that work and we're just ditching it. We have guns. We can take them,"
another job member piped up. The quiet, older man on the team finally spoke. "We have enough money. Greed will only get us all killed. We have to leave while we still can." They dropped the money, checked their weapons, and then ran out to the van. The boss got into the driver's seat and took off down a back alley. Just as they were about to make it into the main road, the police cut them off. Reacting quickly, Boss kicked it into reverse and made for the other end. However, that outlet was cut off by the cops as well.
"Oh shit! What do we do now?"
the young member said nervously. Boss looked to his left. There was a small back alley that was aligned with a side door. He answered, "Out the side. Get out of here. I'll keep them busy." "Yeah, but what about the cash in here?" one of the other members responded. "It's only gonna slow you down. Now go," the boss said, almost angrily. The police were starting to sweep down the alley. The two members jumped out the side and booked it down the path. The old man and the boss stayed in the van. Boss looked in the rearview mirror. "I wonder, why are you staying here? You could easily run," the old man said calmly. "I don't like being lied to, even if it means I have to go to prison. I want to know why," Boss said. The old man gave a small chuckle. "How did you know? Come on, you were quiet the whole time. You weren't worried when your mask fell off and the bankers saw you. And you didn't get violent with them, even when you needed to. Almost like you were avoiding it, so you wouldn't be charged with anything," the boss replied. "So, what's in it for you, turning me in like this?" "A pardon for my past sins," the old man responded. "The police can't forgive you. Only God can. Why don't you ask him, personally?" The boss turned around and shot the old man in the head. He then threw the gun out the window and put his hands behind his head. The police ripped the door open and dragged him out. The boss sat in an interrogation cell. The door opened to reveal a detective. He sat down at the table the boss was cuffed to. The detective lit up a cigarette. "We'll start with a simple question. Where did the other two go?" he asked. "I'm a better class of criminal than that old man. I'm no snitch. Besides, if they didn't go to the meeting point, and they probably didn't, then I have no idea." The detective blew smoke in the boss's face. "Criminals have no class. Stealing from people shows a lack of respect." The boss smirked. "Right, the bank that is insured for millions of euros is really feeling the hurt. I would like to ask, how many other people did the old guy sell out?"
"Several. But actually, you did us a favor. Now we don't have to pay for his witness protection. For once, you Americans and your lust for killing people came in handy."
The detective smugly drew from his cigarette again. "Coming from Italy and what with the mob and all, that's a compliment," Boss replied. "How about this? You tell me where the other two went, and I'll make sure the extradition notice actually makes it to your government," the detective said with a sly grin. "No, I thought I'd stay for a bit, you know. Enjoy those lavish cells, bribe a guard or two, get out in a week," Boss responded sarcastically. A knock came at the door just before the detective was about to flick his cigarette butt at the boss. The detective left the room. He could hear murmured voices on the other side, and then what sounded like the detective becoming angry. The metal door opened again. This time, two men in suits showed up. "So, which one of you is good cop?" the boss said, coyly. They uncuffed him grabbed him by the arms, and walked him out of the room. When they got outside, a black car pulled up. There were no markings on it or brands. A large man sat in the back. The boss suddenly realized what this was. Shit. A bag was put over his head, and he was stuffed into the back seat. After the other two men got in, the car began moving.
"Do you know who I am?"
A low, booming voice spoke out. "Let me guess. Some guy I stole money from?"
"Get in line, buddy. You aren't the first,"
boss retorted.
"Not just some guy you've stolen money from. The guy you've stolen money from. Since you came to Italy."
The voice came back. The boss responded sarcastically. "Damn, that was all you? Thanks for the cash then." Low voice was smooth in its response.
"I may not be the first person you've stolen money from, but I will be the last. When you wake up, remember this carefully. No one steals from Dante Viergo and gets away clean."
With that, the boss was knocked unconscious. A voice called out in the darkness.
"Wake up, son. A sleeping man is unsafe in this place."
The boss's head was groggy, unclear. His eyes slowly opened to a thankfully dim area. There was only a faint orange glow from the candles, and a brighter source from somewhere he couldn't see yet. The figure from which the voice came from helped him up. The boss took some time to clear his head, to suffer the pounding in the back of it from where he was struck.
"Slowly now. They hit you quite hard, harder than they usually do,"
the older sounding voice said. The boss rubbed his neck, wincing from the tender spot.
"Where am I?" he asked. "Diabolus Foraminis, the devil's hole,"
the old voice answered.
"Let me guess, a prison,"
the boss said, annoyed.
"Very perceptive."
"So what? No trial? No court of law?" the boss uttered, realizing how ridiculous his question was as soon as he heard it aloud. The voice answered in a stoic tone.
"Not here. The rule of man is blind to this place, and everyone who resides here. As far as you should be concerned, this is now your home, and your grave."
The boss looked at the figure, still covered in shadow.
"Who are you?"
The voice took a moment, then declared,
"Nazra. I help newcomers adjust to this place. Now, who are you?"
"People call me boss." Nazra chuckled slightly.
"I'm afraid down here there are no bosses, and no one to respect that title either. You have nothing to lose by saying who you really are."
The boss paused for a second. "Call me Zulu then.
Strange, but it will work."
"What kind of a name is Nazra?" boss said, as if trying to upstage the strangeness of their names.
"Arabic. After all, you are in Algeria."
Boss looked confused.
"Algeria? Last I knew, I was in Italy. This is where the Viergo family dumps its enemies, among other people."
"How did you know it was them?" boss spoke, vocalizing his usual suspicion.
"You aren't the first person they've thrown in here, and you won't be the last. Now, let me show you around this place."
Nazra helped Boss to his feet. He was unsteady and still blurry from his injury. Boss walked with Nazra, arm over shoulder, as he was guided towards the brighter light. After adjusting, he was greeted to a large, open area. The room behind them was just one of many miniature caves embedded into the rock wall that surrounded the whole place. Looking up, Boss realized they were at least 1,000 feet underground. the top of the prison exposed to the sky. "Who the hell built all of this?" Boss said in astonishment. "There are theories, but I find it easier not to question the feats of excavation that led to the creation of this place," Nazar replied quietly. As they walked through the courtyard, many prisoners stopped and stared at them. Boss looked over at Nazar. "A white man down here is a rarity. Keep to yourself, and they should pay you no mind," Nazar muttered. "That's the one thing I'm better at than stealing." Nazar led Boss through various rooms and hallways within the stone walls. He was warned to stay near the center until he was used to the maze, unless he had a guide with him. Otherwise, he may end up lost, or the other prisoners may attack him if he were to travel alone in the tunnels. The food for the prison was grown in gardens, using minerals and what little sunlight they could. Water came from a small ground reservoir. It was awful, basic, but it kept the prisoners alive. There were gangs within the prison, like any other. There were supremacists, cultists, the crazed, and several calmer groups that kept to themselves. Nazar belonged to one such group, Mentem Incolentium, the Mind Dwellers. They were the great thinkers of the prison, and the other inmates had a fair amount of respect for the group. However, for someone to join them right away without proving their mind, like Boss seemed to be doing, offended many of the inmates. Nazar led Boss down a cave into a room in which the Mind Dwellers resided. "Here, you can come to explore your mind, and perhaps find yourself," Nazar spoke. "So, philosophy?" Boss asked, making no attempt at hiding his sarcasm. "This prison can only restrict our physical bodies," Nazar responded. "But our minds can explore vast cosmos and the deepest depths of ourselves. I am not a prisoner, Zulu. I am freer than most men can ever be. Think about it. I have a steady source of food and a bed to sleep in at night. I have no debts, no expectations to maintain. I am free to let my mind wander and explore," Nazar replied. "Sounds like you've become institutionalized," Boss said with a smirk. "Maybe I have, but it works for me," Nazar replied simply. Several hours into his stay, Boss noticed there were no guards. Nazar explained that with how isolated the prison was, there is no chance for escape. The prisoners police themselves. For the next few days, Boss stayed close to the philosophers. Other prisoners verbally harassed him with slurs made for the prison, and others more well known to the above-ground culture. However, since he stayed with the Mind Dwellers, they never got physical. Boss tallied the days he spent down there. Nazar approached him as he was carving a line to indicate the fourth day. "Why do you keep track of the days?" Nazar inquired. "Not my first time in prison. I find that keeping the time helps me from going stir crazy," the boss responded. "I must admit, I've long forgotten how many days I've spent here. I pay no mind to the date or year. Down here it is either night or day." While trying to map out the tunnel system in his head on the fifth day, the lack of physical intimidation the boss had enjoyed came to an end. Several prisoners trapped him in a dead end, and the boss soon found himself surrounded. The prisoners held crude stone objects, roughly chiseled to a point. "Come on now, four against one? This hardly seems fair," Boss said. One of the prisoners answered in broken English. "You spent all time with Mind Dweller. You think you're smarter than us."
"Well, I can speak English better than you, so yeah, I think I am."
With that insult, the four rushed the boss. He was able to get in a few good punches, but was quickly subdued by the four men. but rather than stabbing him with their blunt spearheads, they dragged him further into the cave system. The light grew thinner as the stone walls got rougher. This area of the prison was not used much. Soon, the boss would find out why. One of the prisoners jammed their crude spearheads into the boss's right leg, then hit him in the head. The men left him in the dark, bleeding and on the verge of passing out. After the disorientation wore off, Boss found he was unable to stand, nor could he tell which way the group of prisoners had gone. Boss could feel the blood oozing from his leg. He attempted to apply pressure and work through the pain. After his breathing slowed, he became aware of something that was being masked by his heart rate and grunting. Something else was moving down there with him. With his left hand, he searched for a rock to use as a weapon. Given the stony nature of the place, he found one with ease. There he laid, as silent as possible, knowing that any sound might draw the attention from the inmates stalking him. Further in front of him, Boss heard labored breathing, along with multiple footsteps on the stone ground. Nazra came into the Mind Dweller cavern, noticing that Boss wasn't there either. "Have any of you seen Zulu?" Nazra asked the other philosophers. "Not since this morning. He said he was going to memorize the tunnels today," one of them replied. Nazra quickly exited the cave, knowing that the boss was either lost or worse. Searching tunnel after tunnel, Nazra knew something had happened. He went into the courtyard and found a cultist. "Have you seen Zulu?" Nazra spoke quickly. "Who?" the scrawny man replied. "The white man. Where is he?" The cultist peered around himself, making sure no supremacist was around to hear him. "I was heading to my ritual room when four men cornered your, Zulu friend. I didn't see much, but I do know they dragged him off into the Forgotten Path," the scrawny cultist whispered. Nazareth's eyes grew wide. He moved as quickly as his old body would let him. It took him several minutes to get to the Forgotten Path. Only a few feet in, he found Boss passed out, covered in lacerations. Nazra dragged his limp body as far as he could before needing help from the others. Boss could feel the cold concrete on his face and heard a droning sound all around him. As he opened his eyes, he could see spotlights illuminating two figures in some sort of machine. Soon, he realized he was in the underground vault. He rose up, rushing towards Zulu and the rookie, trying to stop them from drilling through the vault door. He also wanted to subdue the rookie before he could betray them. As he ran, the corridor kept growing longer. He couldn't reach them until it was too late. As soon as the drill broke through the door, the vault burst open. A blinding light engulfed them as fleshy tentacles grabbed Zulu and the rookie, pulling them into the light before they could react. Another appendage grabbed Boss by the legs, dragged him into the vault slowly. He tried to grab anything he could to resist the pull, but the tentacle was far too strong. As he was dragged into the light, Boss snapped awake. Another dream of the vault. Nazra was still cleaning out the lacerations on Boss's chest and arms, his leg now properly bandaged. "Back in recovery again," the boss said, chuckling weakly. "You've been out for hours. Luckily for you, we have a variety of medicinal plants down here," Nazra replied while dabbing a liquid on the wounds. "What were those things, Nazra?" Boss asked, turning to look at Nazra. The old man went still, but remained silent. "Something was down there with me, and they didn't sound like inmates." Nazra let out a breath.
There's more to this prison than just its location. There are things here that mere man cannot fully understand. One of those things is what attacked you. We call them subterraneans. The light starved. They were prisoners who went to the depths of this hole and did not come back up. They now worship the darkness. They have been molded by it, changed by their rejection of the sun and its cleansing power. The boss laid there and listened. They feed off whatever they find in the ground that's edible, and they dig further each day. At night, if you listen closely, you can hear their rigid fingers clawing away at the rough stone. Those things were prisoners, Boss said. That's impossible. They didn't even look close to being human. This prison will do things to a man. Things that are unnatural. Evil. Nazra continued. My name is William, Boss said suddenly, catching Nazra off guard. That's my truth. Now, tell me the truth about this place. Nazra set his medical equipment down. He took William's right hand and lifted his arm, then twisted it slightly and pointed to his underarm. There was a tattoo he never had before. It was a Greek symbol. Omega, Nazra spoke. That is the curse mark of this place. A curse mark? William asked incredulously. It is the last letter in the Greek alphabet. The end. This place is where we end, down here. This mark, this curse, it keeps us confined here, till death. The old man said, with a deep inflection. How? This prison, as you know, has no guards or security. But it does have a warden. Nazra had an air of darkness to his voice. The reason there is no concern with escaping prisoners is because anyone who tries to escape is made insane. Their mind is broken. The warden, the curse, it keeps us here. Lest we go mad, like the crazed you have seen. What is this place? William asked. Purgatory. William fell silent, trying to process this information. He would have thought Nazra to be a fool, a crazy old man. However, what he experienced in the darkness, glances of the light-starved creatures as they followed him, while he dragged himself back up the path. Their overexpanded irises, their white skin, their fingers that seemed to be made of bone more than skin, their shattered and blackened teeth. William began to speak again. A job I pulled 2 years ago, back in America. An underground vault. Something was in it. Something that shouldn't have been there. He paused, the memory sending him reeling back. There was some kind of creature in it, one that our team released on accident. It killed my friend, Zulu. We had this new guy with us. He knew it was down there and he played us. The thing in there was giving him nightmares, as long as it didn't receive a sacrifice. So I gave him to the creature. I see. You aren't new to the realm of impossibility, Nazra replied. It's made me question reality, and I don't like doing that. Who knows? Maybe I'm already crazy. They sat there in the dim candlelight for some time. Finally, Nazra spoke. Your body will be fine, but your mind has been injured for quite some time. Stay with the philosophers and allow us to heal your psyche. He held his hand out to William. I guess it took me going to prison to find a decent therapist, William said with a chuckle, grabbing Nazra's hand and shaking it. As the days went on, and William began to go down the path of the Mind Dwellers, his daily tally marks were soon forgotten. His mind became occupied by the memories he was now reliving and answering for. William was one of the harder subjects Nazra took on. He was trying to cut through years of mental seclusion. William was a very defensive person, as Nazra quickly learned. It was a mental defense to avoid looking weak. Showing emotions was something William had learned would get him killed in his life of crime. So, he hid them away, made them taboo to express. William's pride controlled him. It wouldn't allow him to expose anything other than a hardened exterior. But like many hardened men, there was one person who could get through William's walls. Her name was Emma. She, like William, was a criminal. It only took one job with her to know he wanted to keep her around. It was during the second job he knew he wanted her. And it was by their third job together that he considered leaving it all behind to be with Emma, without the fear of being imprisoned and separated from her. Finally, Nazra broke through many of the barriers William had put up to keep those memories away. And when he did, the tragedy was also uncovered. You speak of her only in the past. Why is that? Nazra questioned William. I should have known to get out before I went too far. But I wanted more money. I was trying to get enough so me and Emma could live a life outside of all that shit. Seems like a stupid idea now, but I wanted to get a house on some foreign beach somewhere. Never have to work a day in my life, you know. So I could be with her all the time. Probably makes me seem like a fool, right? He replied. Nazra maintained a calm demeanor. Crime rarely leads to an easy life afterwards, but for someone like you, to use it as a means to make a decent life for someone else, no one can fault you for trying. William rubbed his eyes before continuing. We were running a bank job in New York, had some new guy with us. He was reckless, trying to make a name for himself, you know. Cops came, like they usually do. We had to get out. They knew we were armed, so they came in, guns blazing. They got orders from an affected party to take us down. The new guy froze up and wouldn't move. Emma, she was trying to cover him, get him to snap out of it. She was like that, you know. Cared too much about people around her. Caring can be a fault. What happened in the end? Nazra spoke with a softer voice. Kid was behind cover and wouldn't get out with the rest of the crew. Emma went back for him and the cops took her. They took her down. William's voice shook while he spoke. Are you still angry about this? Why the fuck wouldn't I be? That was some time ago. There is no shame in letting it free. This pride you hold on to, the pride that keeps you from exploring the rest of yourself. It is destructive. Maybe I want to be destructive, William replied darkly. Maybe I deserve it for bringing that idiot onto the team. So you blame him for her death? Nazra asked simply. Of course I do. If he didn't freeze up like a goddamn coward, she wouldn't have gone back for him.
she'd still be here, and I wouldn't be in this fucking hole.
Just the same, if you hadn't done that job in the first place, that situation wouldn't have happened.
Save the butterfly effect shit for someone else. I would have made that job work if it wasn't for him. The crew lost a lot of money, and I lost her.
Why do you speak of the loss of money along with the loss of Emma?
Nazareth questioned. That was the money I was going to use to get us out of that life. After she was gone, there was just no point in stopping.
I see. You've replaced the love and loss of Emma with the unending hunger of greed. Something that you can never truly satiate. Something that you can never truly lose.
Nazareth spoke heavily, the weight of his words not being lost on William.
I have no doubt you recognize the futility of this effort, as material possessions are no substitute for the wholeness of another. Perhaps this was meant to happen, to teach you.
You and I both know that fate stuff is bullshit. William snapped back at Nazareth. That kid got her killed. Plain and simple.
You must learn to let go of this anger, William. It will be difficult, but it will poison you the longer you hold on to it. I believe you must reconcile with this young man if there was a way out of here.
William continued, as if ignoring the wisdom Nazareth had just given him.
Worst part is, he died on some other job. I didn't even get the chance to do it myself.
As the days passed, Nazareth made more progress in deconstructing the emotional blocks William was keen on maintaining. Nazareth was not one to look down on others for their faults, as he was not without sin himself. William subconsciously knew this, but some part of him still felt that Nazareth was trying to hold the moral high ground. Of course, he knew this wasn't actually the case, but his ever-unfolding emotional state clouded his mind. However, Nazareth never seemed to patronize him, talk down to, or demean him. This allowed William's silent anger to unwind and let him open up to Nazareth more comfortably, without feeling weak. William approached Nazareth after one of their sessions.
You know, you never did tell me how you ended up down here. I suppose it's only fair you learn about me, if only to humanize me more in your eyes.
Nazareth began.
I was a young man in southern Libya. Like you, I was an ambitious criminal, though I'm afraid my feats of thievery were relegated to merely simple theft, and not the grandiose jobs you wear so proudly. My greatest failure and disgrace was during an attempt at a larger crime with a close friend.
The old man went silent for a moment, reliving a memory he cared not to think of often.
A local wealthy man lived in a mansion of sorts near the edge of the village. We wanted a piece of that wealth. Our greed told us we deserved that money more than he did, despite the hard work he did to earn it. We were able to steal a bounty of gold coins before we were found out. As me and my companion fled, the guards chased us. My friend lost his footing over some pottery in the courtyard and fell. But rather than staying behind with him or helping him up, I let him serve as my distraction while I escaped.
Nazareth once again paused, now coming to the hardest part of the story.
In that village, the punishment for theft was death. They served my friend this punishment. I, however, was able to avoid capture for a few days, but ultimately, my own foolishness led them right to me. Upon my capture, I found that the wealthy man didn't want me dead, as my friend was. He wanted me to suffer for my transgressions, for abandoning my friend, So, I was thrown into this hole and forgotten.
And you never tried to escape? William questioned.
At first I did, and... well, I soon found out there was no escape. So I learned to accept this place and thrive in it.
That's the second time you've hesitated, William said.
On what?
About there being a way out. The first time was when we talked about Emma.
Your perception is as keen as always.
Nasra, is there a way out of here? The old man paused, contemplating his decision. After a moment, he closed his eyes and spoke.
Yes, there is.
How do I do it?
That's just it. You can't. Many have tried before you, and none ever survived. Most died only a few dozen meters in.
Nasra uttered with an almost pleading voice. Nasra, I can't live down here. I would rather die trying than become complacent. You know this. He sat, taking his time to decide. If he told William, he could be sealing this man's fate.
My friend was smart, like you, Nasra began. He was the better thief. He was the better friend. You remind me of him. Your actions in the vault, killing your friend, rather than letting him succumb to the horrors of the unknown. That shows a level of mercy I did not know in my youth. He would have stayed with me if I was the one who had fallen.
Nazareth's face was filled with regret.
Maybe this way I can repay that debt I owe to him. To help another friend freedom. Whether in this life or the other.
Give me liberty. Or give me death, Nasra.
If you do this, the old man had certainty in his voice, you must go all the way.
What do I have to do?
We must train your mind. This escape route, this cave, it is not one you will face many physical dangers in. It is one that will test your will, your psyche. In order to survive, you must have an iron resolve.
Nasra had a determination in his voice William hadn't heard before.
You will go through the same things all lost souls do. The trials and tribulations of hell.
Hours passed and days blurred together as Nasra prepared William's mind. The old man began to rework how William approached his feelings. Greed, lust, anger, sadness, all of them. During another mental session, William finally asked Nasra a question that had been on his mind for some time.
How do you know it's a mental trial in the cave?
Because I attempted it myself shortly after I was placed down here.
Nasra began.
I know not if it is the cave itself, or the warden, but it plays to your mind. It will find your deepest secrets, your worst demons, and it will bring them forth. Mine were too great to push through. I had to turn back. It was easier for me to accept this prison than to go through that hell.
And no one can fault you for that. William said, repeating Nazareth's comforting words.
I must warn you, William. The entrance has changed since my time. Those who were driven insane by the trials and the light starved dwell within the entrance. It is expansive and dark. You must not try to fight them, as this would be as foolish as trying to fight the forces of hell. Know your strengths, and know
that no amount of muscle will help you in this escape. Only swift feet and a strong mind will aid you here.
How far did you get in? William asked.
Only to the second trial, that of violence and treachery. The deeds of my past came to haunt me once again, and I was too afraid to face them. I had to turn back.
Great. I'm only 30, and I've made enough enemies for a lifetime. This should be fun.
I did not have the will to face them, but I believe you do. You've already faced one devil, and you've kept your head on your shoulders. There are few in this prison that have changed as much as you have, and even fewer who could rely on that change. I haven't felt this much faith in someone as I do now, in a long time. Thank you, William.
The two men scavenged supplies for the next several days, enough food for at least 48 hours, and water for one day. After accumulating enough resources, the hour was finally upon them. As William adorned his cloth sack that held his food, and his animal skin bladder that contained his water, Nazra came to him.
I have given it some thought, Nazra suddenly said. You came down here under a different name, but now your mind has been changed, and hopefully freed from much of its past guilt. Like King Saul, you have found a new self.
Maybe I should change my name to Paul, make it come full circle, William said with a smirk. Nazra patted him on the shoulder and led him out of the cell. They followed several tunnels to the stone oasis. Nazra, I think we have enough water, William said, confused.
Yes, but one of the streams from the source will lead us to the entrance.
I thought you knew where it was.
I do. We must follow the stream, or else you will not be able to enter the true cave.
A sudden gust of wind swept through the prison, and with it, a magnitude of dust. Within seconds, the whole prison was left in a haze, the sand and dirt assaulting their skin.
Come now, I know the way.
Nazra spoke into William's ear. Nazra grabbed William's hand and began to pace forward. They could see hazy figures running by, trying to take shelter from the storm. Minutes later, the men who had assaulted William weeks prior stormed into the oasis, grabbing a cultist.
Where did White Man go?
The prisoner demanded.
They followed the river,
the cultist uttered, pointing to the stream offshooting the water source. The men rushed down the path. Nazra and William stood before the cave entrance, the stream lying between them.
I don't hear anybody in there, William said. They don't know you're here yet. Once you cross this stream, the horrors of hell will be waiting for you.
Nazra then grabbed William's shoulders and spoke slowly.
When you are sure there is no one around you, then light your torch. Be sure you are alone, or it will alert them. And if you get lost, remember, always head for the darkest part of the cave. You must traverse the Valley of Shadows before you can find the light.
Right, William answered.
And William, if, when you escape, find that one who can fulfill you again. And don't turn back. This prison is not your home. It is better to die trying to obtain freedom than to live in captivity.
Nazra hugged William with these last words. As the prisoners turned the last corner, they found Nazra standing alone at the cave entrance.
Where is White Man, old man?
The lead prisoner barked.
He is beyond your reach, Nazra said with a hint of confidence.
The lead prisoner pushed Nazra aside, and the four rushed past the stream, crossing into the entrance. William was surrounded in darkness. What light did come from the opening
was already weakened by the dust storm. He was now in the thick of it. Not even his hands were visible, right in front of him. He could hear occasional noises, some similar to what he heard in the light-starved den. With paced steps and staggered breathing, he slowly made his way forward. Several minutes into his trek, all sound around William ceased, and he found himself in deafening silence. With this, William crouched down to spark a rock off the ground and light his torch. Just as he was about to strike his rock against the ground, he heard a fluttering sound, which then became more distinct. It was footsteps, several of them. William stood back up and began to quicken his pace. Even though the ground was mostly smooth, there was the occasional rock formation that could break an ankle if one wasn't careful. As he attempted to jog in the blind darkness, he could hear the footsteps behind him keeping pace. Within seconds, the clamor of sound was right behind him. With a sudden impact, William was sent down to the ground, hard. His stone slammed against the rock surface hard enough to send a few sparks, one of which landed on his torch. The oil ignited brightly, blinding everyone for several seconds. William was flipped over by the lead prisoner, who kneeled over him. He was still blurry from the fall when the prisoner spoke. "Now, I kill you." As the prisoner raised a large stone above William's head, there was a sudden screeching sound from the direction the prisoners had come. William flipped back over on his hands and knees and attempted to crawl away. However, the lead man grabbed the cloth sack and held him in place. The panting and screeching grew louder behind them, and as they were all distracted, William undid the knot to his cloth sack, becoming free of the man's grip. He grabbed his torch and ran as fast as he could down the cave. Just as the lead prisoner reacted to William's escape, the light-starved swarmed the four men. William only heard the screams and wet crunches of the men being torn apart. As he ran, he smothered the flame to conceal his position. William ran through the darkness, getting as far as he could before slowing. This way, he could lose his enemies as his breathing and steps became quieter. He couldn't be sure, but the distance he crossed seemed to be several dozen feet. As he made measured paces in the dark, the air around him seemed to be getting thicker and warmer. He rubbed his fingers together and realized they were damp. William's breath resonated off something near him. As he reached his left hand out, it met a rock wall. He decided it was time to light his torch. If he had hit a dead end, he didn't want to circle back to the light-starved. William placed the torch in his left hand and drew a sparking stone with his right. With the air being damp, getting a spark was difficult. With a final, angled strike on the rock, which also scraped his fingers against the wall, a glowing fragment of stone was able to land on his torch and ignite it. In the dim light, William saw he had torn the skin near his fingernails. There was blood, but the injury was less than critical. He placed the stone back in his pocket and checked his surroundings. Behind him was obscured by the fog that he now found himself in. In front was the wall. William took a second to establish his direction. He faced his right side to the wall, placing his hand on it, then placed his torch against the yearning darkness to his left. William was going to use his right hand as a method of judging distance, by walking as straight as he could, keeping a constant distance from the wall. His right arm would either extend to show the wall was sloping further back, or his arm would contract, showing it was curving back around. William kept a close focus on his steps, making sure not to deviate, lest he get inaccurate judgments from his already makeshift idea. The wall was uneven, causing his arm to shift many times, forcing him to stop and make sure his distance was still the same. After a dozen feet or so, his arm was fully extended, and his hand was losing contact with the wall. Either this was a large dip in it, or the wall was leading to another passage. With no other option, William decided to follow it. He walked another distance before something became apparent. The fog was getting denser. The wall right next to him, despite how close the torch was to it, was getting difficult to see. Even though William had not heard anything near him, nor was his injury getting worse, he still felt a lingering threat. The fog surrounding him was beginning to make him feel claustrophobic, even though he normally didn't have that issue. But this was not a normal situation. William's pace slowed even more, his breathing getting quicker. He knew he was in no immediate danger, but this fog felt like an adversary all the same. It was suffocating. His steps were now at a snail's pace, with his focus now on the fog, rather than the wall. William soon found himself in the middle of the blur. He snapped out of the anxiety, remembering that the wall was to his right. However, when he reached for it, there was nothing but more mist. He turned to walk to the direction he knew the wall came from, but the old path never appeared. How did this happen, he thought. I couldn't have traveled that far from it. William was now stranded in a sea of destitution. A thousand thoughts ran through his mind, most of which were near hopeless attempts at finding a marker or milestone he could base his position off of. William had made a fatal error when looking for the wall. He allowed himself to lose his sense of direction. With no idea where he was, William fell to the ground. This is it, he thought. There was no way to get further in, no way to escape this mess. What chance do I have to beat this cave, to escape this hell when no one else has? Why would I be the exception? His limbs felt heavy. The air was difficult to take in, and it felt like a chore to even think. William lost his focus on the world. He sat there, letting minutes slip away. He was unsure of how much time had passed when an idea struck his mind. He would walk in a single direction. Even if he ended up back at the entrance to the cave, he could find that wall again and not make the mistake of losing it this time. This idea filled his limbs with motivation. He took a few deep breaths, getting as much air as he could in this water-filled atmosphere, and rose back up. With this spark of movement, he proceeded at a steady pace, in a path he felt was the one he would make further progress in. The torch flickered as the water in the air was choking the flame. William couldn't tell how much time or distance had passed, but he could tell the fog was getting thinner. This development made his legs move much quicker, now with a sense of determination. As William cleared the fog, he found himself in a cavern. Each wall was at least 30 feet away, and only the smallest amount of torchlight reflected off of them. However, in front of him was more blackness. Something on one of the cave walls stuck out heavily. There was another torch mounted to the wall. William rushed over to it and lit it. As the wall torch ignited, it became incredibly bright, more so than it reasonably should have. William turned around to see the rest of the area he was in, quickly noticing several figures charging at him. He quickly dashed to the left, avoiding their blades which impacted the rock wall, chipping some away. The figures refocused on him, and once again sprinted at him. William got to his feet and ran. Are these more light-starved? He thought. However, he remembered that in both encounters with the creatures,
They never had weapons. Whoever these people were, they were intelligent and angry. As William ran, he found a decently angled rock on the ground, one he could use as a bludgeon. He scooped it up while still running, and after getting more distance, turned around to face his aggressors. As one raised their weapon to stab him, William ducked and rammed the rock into his stomach, knocking the man back on the ground. Just as William was about to slam his rock into the man's head, another figure kicked him in his ribs, sending him sprawling across the ground and knocking the torch out of his hand. The impact completely knocked the wind out of him and cracked a few of his ribs.
"What the fuck was that?"
William grunted. As the figure ran past the torch, William saw a flash of his enemy's face. It stunned him. The man had the face of the old man he killed before getting caught in Italy. The bullet was still lodged in his head. William suddenly remembered what Nazra told him about personal demons coming out in this cave. He was facing the projection of his own violence. There was no way to beat it with force. Realizing this, he ran. William grabbed a torch on the wall and headed for the darkest part of the cave, just as Nazra had told him to do. Pushing through the burning pain from the broken bones in his chest, William ran until he found himself at a dead end. He looked around him, trying to find a passage, but there were none. He now heard a multitude of people behind him, and when he turned, he saw a horde coming for him. The crowd came down on him. William was held against the wall and stabbed by hundreds of blades. Despite the impossible odds and his body being torn apart, William still fought to be free. Just as he was on the verge of passing out, he finally saw one last face in front of him. The rookie, holding a sharp knife. William's throat was slit, and he fell to the floor, defeated. He woke up and rose quickly. Upon feeling his chest and stomach, William realized there were no injuries on him. The only injury he retained was the scraped fingers he had from sparking his torch. The crowd was nowhere to be seen. William saw his torch still laying on the ground, though it did not burn nearly as brightly as before. "Must have been out for a while," he thought. William also realized the other torch was gone as well. He slowly rose to his feet, still shaking from the adrenaline. He stumbled over to his original torch and grabbed it, tilting it to brighten the flame. William turned around, now seeing that the dead end was open. He decided not to question it and proceed. As William progressed through the tunnel, once again, a thick fog began to encompass him. However, there was no more anxiety or feelings of suffocation from it. He knew the trick. As William walked further, his stomach began to groan. He remembered he hadn't eaten much in hours. The preparation for his journey had kept him too busy to feed. William began to pass through the thickest part of the fog, his stomach growling with hunger. Once the fog started to thin, he saw something beyond him, a dim glow. His pace quickened. As the light grew brighter, something became apparent to William. The scent of food. His belly ached at the aroma and made him move faster. As he entered the new expanse, he saw another torch on the wall, and something truly strange. A flat stone platform carved from the wall, with a feast set upon it. The food was immaculate. Chicken, beef, pork, fruits, vegetables, pastries, and wine were arranged on the stone table. William stood over the spread, wondering how it got there. but wondering more about what he should start with. He took up a knife and cut a portion of steak. He stabbed it with a fork and lifted it to his mouth. But just before the savory meat touched his teeth, his eyes shot open and he threw the fork across the cave. William backed away from the feast, realizing what it was. Temptation. If he had taken even a single bite, he knew he would not have stopped. As William backed away, a sound became audible, that of grinding metal and tearing paper. He turned to see a figure sitting on the ground, hunched over and seemingly eating something. The figure turned around to reveal its face. It was William, or some depraved version of him. He was grotesquely fat, his mouth dripping with saliva as he chewed on dollar bills and coins.
"Want some?"
the creature asked in a lethargic voice. William stood there, appalled by what he was seeing.
"Come on. You can't get enough of it, right? You need more. You always need more."
The creature continued to slowly chew on the currency, shoving another handful into its maw. William's stomach growled harshly, an ache that made him wince.
"Get your fill, if you can."
William's hunger made the food behind him seem so worth the damnation. But another sound broke that temptation. A squeak. On the ground, in a darker part of the cavern, was a rat.
"Get a fill of humility."
William picked up a rock and brought it down on the rat, crushing its head. He picked up a knife from the table and gathered the rat. He skinned the rat to the best of his ability and, using his torch as a bonfire, cooked what meat he could find on it over the fire. The meat was foul, and William could barely keep it down. But it was necessary. Something suddenly occurred to him. He still had his water pouch. He quickly pulled it around himself and uncapped it, drinking enough to get the taste of burnt vermin out of his mouth. William sat for a moment, letting his stomach settle before moving on. Standing up, William looked back at his engorged counterpart. The grotesque version of William stared back at him, then spit out a few coins. "I think I'm full," the sloth William said, in a more normal voice. Now aware of the tunnel beyond the cavern, William continued. As he once again traversed the fog, he noticed a sound in the distance, carried on the air. He couldn't be sure, and he almost didn't want to be. But it sounded almost like erotic release. As William exited the fog, it became undeniable. Someone, or something, was experiencing ecstasy. The torchlight began to bounce off multiple surfaces, all moving and undulating. As William approached, it became clear there were dozens of women, all naked and moving in suggestive ways. Some of the faces he recognized to be women he had worked and later slept with. Others seemed to be merely women he had seen passing by, but thought of in lustful ways. They began to surround him, their hands rubbing every inch of his body, their voices reverberating in the cave, breathing words of seduction. They pressed their exposed bodies against him, pleading for him to take them.
Every mechanism of William's male psyche was telling him to give in, to let himself be enraptured by the sea of sexuality around him. He knew it was all false. But in that moment, it felt, sounded, and smelled real. One of the women wrapped her arms around him. Her essence of confidence was purely intoxicating. William made the mistake of looking into her eyes. They were deep and blue, and seemed to put him in a trance. The world began to fall away around him, as this seductress pulled at his soul. In his blurred mind, a word broke through, spoken by a voice William could barely remember. Fulfill. With a deep breath, William returned to the world, looking up and past the crowd. He saw a familiar face. It was Emma. William released the woman's arms from around him and began to wade through the mass. The women began to move in ways meant to attract a man, exposing themselves to him. William could see them in the corners of his vision, but Emma was at the center, allowing him to stay focused on her, and her alone. Just as William grew near to her, dozens of hands grabbed at him, holding him back. He reached his right hand out to Emma. She raised her hand gently and grabbed it. In an instant, the horde of women vanished, as William felt her hand again. His mind was pulled back to sobriety. William pulled Emma in close and held her tightly.
Why are you here?
William's voice was shaky. I wasn't going to let those cheap things take you away. Emma replied, confidently. William kissed her for the first time in years. I'm here to help you. I want you to be free of this. Emma spoke with a sense of compassion William had almost forgotten. She took him by the hand and began to lead him down the next tunnel. The fog that came was as suffocating as always, but with her right there with him, William moved with the confidence this cave had robbed him of. However, Emma's grip soon began to loosen. Before he could react, she disappeared in front of him, into the fog that surrounded them. William called out desperately, but Emma did not respond. He stood there, in the mist for several moments, despite seeing the way she had gone. William was afraid. With this fear still coursing through his veins, he decided to run forward. As he moved, a light appeared and began to grow brighter in the distance. William slowed his pace as he got closer, becoming confused at the sight he was seeing. As he walked into the room beyond the rock walls, he found himself in some kind of office-like room. As he continued through the building, he realized he was inside a bank. That's when a sound finally became audible. Police sirens. William skulked into the main lobby, moving more slowly as the realization of where he was began to strike him. There, a heist was being interrupted by the cops. That's when he noticed the label on the patrol cars. NYPD. He was back in New York, at the job where Emma was killed. With this stark realization, William frantically scanned the lobby for Emma. One of the crew's police radios sparked up. They heard a voice giving the officers the all-clear to fire, an order from an affected party that the chief bent the knee to. As the cops began to fire into the bank, William ducked behind the teller stands. For 30 seconds, the place was ablaze with gunfire. Once it had stopped, William felt a hand on his shoulder. It was Emma.
Listen, I gotta get you out of here.
William spoke quickly. You know that can't happen. You know what this is. Emma's voice had a certainty to it. She turned William to see the young heist member cowering inside one of the offices. He then became aware of something in his hand. A gun.
What will you do? Emma asked.
William charged up to the man and pointed the gun at his head.
If you do this, you will never leave.
She spoke solemnly.
Maybe I shouldn't.
You would come all this way, just to make everything worthless. She almost had a pleading to her words.
Worthless? This is the man that got you killed.
However, Emma did not respond. William looked back to see her lying on the floor, dead, a bullet in her chest. Anger filling him, William whipped around, once again pointing the gun at the rookie crew member. The man was now aware of William's presence. He looked at the gun, then to Emma's body.
What happened?
The man questioned. His cluelessness nearly made William shoot him right there.
What happened to her?
The young man asked once again. Just as William's rage was about to let a bullet fly, he let his arm fall to his side. What happened is, I never should have brought you here. William finally said, in an almost defeated voice.
What do you mean?
William threw his gun to the floor. I knew you didn't have the experience to handle a job like this. I brought you along anyway, so that we could use you as a distraction. There was a grave, confessional tone in William's voice. I brought you just so I could let you die if it was needed. You were collateral to me, but not to her. I was willing to let my greed consume a life for my own gain. And in turn, it devoured what was most important to me. The young man stared at William, unsure of what to say.
I'm sorry for putting you in this situation. I'm sorry for blaming you all these years. I'm sorry that I couldn't tell you this while you were still alive. I'm sorry that I didn't care, like she did.
William felt a hand wrap around his. He turned to see Emma, alive once again. He turned to her.
I wanted us to live outside of all of this. Even if I had gotten the money to do it, I would have wanted more.
You weren't enough for me back then. And you should have been.
If I could just have another chance.
You still can. You're finally getting free from this cage you've built for yourself. Emma spoke softly. William kissed her again, deeply, losing himself in her. When he opened his eyes, he was back in the cave. His torch had gone out, but he didn't need it anymore. He could feel the cave pulling him where he needed to go. Without the torch, the only way William knew he was in the fog was the damp air. But without seeing it, its choking presence seemed to be superficial. As he waded into the thinner mist, another light began to become persistent, small, but bright. The longer he walked, the brighter and larger the light became. His steps began to push stones around, which clinked and resounded off the walls around him. The pure white light began to reflect off the walls as well, revealing that they were now completely flat, like a hallway. The light source was coming from a large square at the end of the corridor. William then recognized something at the end of the hall on the right side. There were gears and other mechanisms embedded in a large metal square, hanging from the source of the light. It was a vault door. William soon realized he was back at Casey's vault. The vault door now hanging wide open. William stopped, his stomach dropping, his heart pumping hard. He clenched his fists, trying to push the fear back down. As he was attempting to suppress it, Nazar's words came back to him. His pride was limiting his psyche, his ability to explore his emotions. He had pushed away all the fear and dread this place had caused him. Each time the memory presented itself, it would put William on the edge of collapse. In the face of the unknown, what had haunted him for the last 2 years, he finally let himself go through the process. William's skin clammed up, his spine tingled, and his knees grew weaker until he fell to the ground, groveling as the memories of what happened began playing out all around him. The skin wall pulling Zulu into it, its tentacles fusing with his skin, his lifeless eyes after William had shot him. The tears of fright, of intensity, of facing a terror of the unknown, flowed down his face. The images he had imagined and suppressed, of himself being subjected to the creature's will, it put a knot in his gut. He saw the rookie being assimilated into the flesh as well, his scowled face struggling not to show the immense pain he was subjected to. Some time passed before the fear began to wear off. Before William could let himself relax, he rose to his feet, his limbs still a bit shaky, but with a newfound confidence filling his body. Behind him was only death. He knew that if he did not move forward, he would be trapped in that cave, body and spirit. However, the path in front of him offered a second option: freedom. Should that precipice kill him, he would still be freed of the pain and fear that was still in him. If he lived, he would not only be physically released, but he could still free himself from his demons with time and effort. Give me liberty, or give me death. William spoke softly into the silence surrounding him. He felt a sensation on his arm. He lifted it and pulled back his clothing, examining his arm. The curse mark was now gone. William walked into the light. Nazra and the other mind dwellers were in their chamber, meditating, when they all suddenly opened their eyes in unison. There was a strange sensation in the air. As they came into the courtyard, the other prisoners began to appear out of the other rooms and caves. They all felt a shift in the atmosphere, one that had never been felt before in this hellish prison. Several of the philosophers looked to Nazra, who, after a moment, began to softly smile. He knew his friend had finally achieved his freedom. A robed figure shuffled through a marketplace in a large southern Libyan village. As it passed by the poor bystanders, gold coins were slipped into their pockets while they paid no mind to the feeble-looking figure near them. The robed person sat against the wall, placed a white box with gold trimming near them. As a starving child passed by, the figure beckoned to the boy. The scrawny kid approached the person with a hint of fear in his eyes. The figure lifted its obscured arm, and 3 gold coins fell to the ground. The boy quickly picked up the currency, then looked back at the cloth-draped person. The child's eyes lit on the box near the figure, recognizing the color scheme. It was the same as the mansion near the edge of town.
"Is this from the rich man?"
the child asked in a hushed tone. The figure lifted its other arm to its covered face. The cloth shifted slightly, falling enough to reveal a white hand. With its fingers curled, save for the index, the person made a shushing motion to the boy, who then smiled and ran off to buy from the nearby baker.